So what did you tell them?
What did I tell them about what?
Why I wasn't there.
I said that you had to go to D.C.
And they accepted that?
Why shouldn't they accept that? You're always going somewhere.
Yeah.
I'd really like to be left alone tonight, if you don't mind.
Oh. Yeah. Sorry.
I put everything in the wash. I wasn't expecting you back.
I know. I'm sorry.
I'm a mathematician, Tom, okay? Like, I don't have time.
A mathematician? You're not a mathematician.
Oh, come on. You don't even know what math is.
Oh, that's bullshit. I know what math is. I'm a lawyer, okay?
Yeah, that is precisely why you don't know what math is.
I might not be good at math, but I know what math is.
Okay,
and you're not a mathematician.
I think it has to do with numbers. Of course I have
no time for you. When the fuck do you do math? When do you do math?
When I'm not with you, which is all the time. I'm inventing things.
Inventing things? What, like numbers and equations? That stuff doesn't mean anything. I'm trying to build a life. I'm trying to build a life with you.
So a life is
for 12 years I've been trying to build a life with you. And you can't even respect that. You
can't
even look at me anymore. You don't even touch me. That's why
what the complaint is about, that I don't touch you? Why don't you make yourself a bit more touchable?
Yes, that's what all this is about. We've tried to talk about this before. And you don't even listen to me.
I have to escape to my little abstract world.
We have this beautiful life that's just a facade. It's a facade. And you're more into your math. You're more into your math than anything else.
Yes, because you are not very engaging. You don't pay me any
I pay you attention so much.
When?
For 12 years, my life was about you. You and our family and building a family. You were off looking at equations and mathematics that you hardly even could do.
Well, exactly. That's why it's a hard profession.
You ruined this.
You did not even try.
You ruined us. You ruined us with your lack of emotion. And at some point, you just couldn't give up your dream of math, mathematics, and equations.
It takes time, Tom.
Time?
You didn't even try to understand.
15 or 20 years?
Yes.
When are you going to realize it's a dream?
These things are hard. Move on to what? This is the only thing that's eternal in me. In anyone.
I hate your mathematics. I hate your mathematics so goddamn much because they take you from me. They take you from me, and they take you from our family.
Jesus Christ, you just gave me an ultimatum. It was either you or the kids, or my math, you said.
And you chose math.
Oh, fuck
you.
You
chose math.
Of course. I mean...
That's what this is about.
No, but it's not supposed to be mutually exclusive like this, Tom.
It is mutually exclusive.
You're supposed to be
supportive. You're taking up so much time of your doing your mathematics.
That's because it's
like that. You don't even care about me anymore.
Okay,
what's been going on for 3 years is this lack of emotional connection between us. The emotional connection is your fucking mathematics. And I'm sick of it.
I couldn't do it anymore, Tom.
I think the proximity makes it a lot more powerful emotionally.
Yeah. Like the first two times we did it, we only went through like the first third of the scene.
Five lines or something.
You know? And it wasn't until probably Saturday that we actually went through the whole scene in front of the class.
Yeah, yeah. That went well.
And it went pretty well,
yeah.
But yeah.
I think it was fun. Yeah, some people are surprised, but like then you. At parties sometimes, you announce. It's probably not the first thing I'll tell somebody that I'm a mathematician. Sometimes it can be positive, but see, the unfortunate thing is that many people have a misconception that math is not very interesting. And it's an unfortunate situation. In fact, I found myself holding that, well, not in particular holding an opinion against mathematics, but not knowing what it's really about until I guess took a course in university, because I was originally a political science major, so I had no idea what it was about. But until I took a course in university that focused on proof and rigor of methods, but in addition introduced me to some ideas in mathematics about its objects, and I realized that it's not at all focused on computation, things like that. It's mainly if you want to investigate anything, you are required to do it via methods that are, I guess, logical and of the highest rigorous standards. And then you allow yourself to draw any conclusion only through this methodology. So mathematics is in a way a very, it's training yourself to think clearly. and then you can investigate anything with those set of tools.
A friend of mine sent me this quote because he was at Princeton. It's under a sculpture of Einstein in Princeton. It says, "The ideals which have lighted my way and time after time have given me the energy to face life have been kindness, beauty, and truth." I mean, at first it seems very like simple, but the more I reflect back on what motivates me, it's exactly the, especially the beauty and the truth part.
I mean, as human beings, we have such intuition about truth. It's like, we have, for example, a very strong intuition that it's binary. There's some, truth can, you know, something must have, a proposition must have a true statement. It is either true or false. I guess you want to know what is the world, and when you start breaking down that question, you want to know what is the case and what is not the case. And it boils down to then, if we want to analyze the world, then what can we say about what is the case? To what extent is it the case? And that has to engages our intuitions of what is truth. And then if you try to formalize that, well, you know, computer scientists would talk about, can we arrive at, well, I guess I'm bringing computer science because I want to tie in this concept of provability and how that's being like examined through an applied mathematical point of view. But so for example, if you want to see if something's true, then as mathematicians, as physicists, you'd want to, or as mathematicians mainly, you want to prove it, and so you want to know what the limits of those of that system is. I mean, as human beings, can we look at the world and analyze it, and how does this analysis fit into reality? Where is it limited? You want to know the limits of your ability to think. There's a lot of, I find all those things very fascinating. Yeah.
You know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Mm-hmm. It's a new day, it's a new dawn, it's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good.
So many things. It's a hard question. I think at some point I wanted to be a dancer. I still do. I mean, I still dance. But I really wanted to be like, I really like the performing arts. So I'd always like sing and dance all over my home. My parents would be very annoyed with me.
So on that level, it's very different from math, because math, you try to discover truths, formal truths. But I mean, the intuitions I use for dance, which are mainly my geometric and visceral intuitions, I enjoy using them, and I enjoy dancing because I want to create new and exciting ways to see movement and things like that. And then there's like areas of math in which, like in particular areas of geometry, and where you're kind of motivated by the very strange geometrical objects that arise in the mathematical world. And I think mathematics actually has, surprisingly to me at first, provided the setting where the most like exotic and beautiful objects, geometric objects I've ever like tried to think about. So, you know, that's like, there's ways to evert the sphere that without intersect, you know, without like smoothly and things like that. And so these are all like mathematical concepts, but they're very, very, very nice. And it's the same intuitions that are being exercised there.
Oh, what is that?
Oh, the flower was dying. So I thought a friend gave it to me. It was dying. A friend gave it to me three days ago, and it was fine. And then it started dying, and so I'm like, okay, I don't want it to die alone in my room, so I'll just bring it out the entire day. I was like, okay, your last day, I'll put it in my bag instead.
It feels empowering that math can solve problems, but I definitely don't think the mathematics I do is going to solve anything immediate about, you know, like, the world right now. I like I like mathematics, I think, more intrinsically through a philosopher's eyes. And I'll put it this way, because most of the questions are usually identified with philosophy. I take it this way, mathematicians and philosophers are both interested to some extent in examining reality, what is true, what is knowledge. Well, I guess that's more so philosophy, what is knowledge, epistemology. But I mean mathematicians as well, they want to understand how things work. But they only examine it using a formal system. And so philosophers also, especially analytic philosophy, are also bound by this very rigorous way of deduction and using logic. And so it's natural that how philosophers look at mathematical reality, they want to question what is it that mathematicians examine, to what extent are mathematical objects real? Why is it that mathematics is so applicable to physics, for example? Why is it so successful? It's not so obvious why it should be if they, like for example, when you were saying, if it's pure mathematics and it was not developed so much is inspired by physics. And so these are the questions that philosophers are interested in and mathematicians at the foundational level.
A result in math that is very interesting because of its philosophical consequences. I was very amazed that something in mathematics can have resounding things to say in philosophy. And that would be Gödel's incompleteness result. And so the theorem basically says that any formal system strong enough to support arithmetic is incomplete. So what does that mean? It means that the notions of truth and provability are different.
So he's able to give you a formal proof of the difference between provability and truth, which usually you would think in your mind, aren't those the same things? I mean, anything that's true you can probably prove, or at least things that you can prove are true. So yes, that's indeed the case, but he showed that the body of true mathematical statements properly encompasses the body of provable mathematical statements.
It makes things seem a bit more, just put it in a metaphorical sense, it's less so of like a glass castle and everything's perfect and pristine, you know. There's a lot more mystery behind what it is what is truth anyways, right? I mean, there's this formal notion of truth expressed in like, for example, in logic using truth tables and stuff. And so that, when we try to capture that notion, the intuitive notion of truth using these formal systems, apparently then it's not synonymous with provability. And so then it makes us think harder. And as human beings, it gives us more of a job than to think about like, what is it that we're trying to do with these formal systems? Like, what are we talking about? And so that's the philosophical, like. Also, where are you in the stuck process? If you have nothing to do, then it's probably more productive. If you have no idea how to proceed, it's probably more productive to think about something else until your brain maybe generates some ideas. If you're stuck, but you kind of feel like, there's a word called like a tip of the tongue phenomenon, where like you almost remember something, you almost understand how it goes, but you just want to put the pieces together and you don't know which way is most fruitful to put it, then it's really exciting to keep on working. But then I guess that you're not really stuck. You feel like there's something to go. So anyways, it depends. It's like you're trying to do something that you don't know the solution for. And so it's like exploring. And so sometimes you feel like it's really exciting, you're seeing beautiful things, and sometimes you just feel like you're lost and you maybe should think about something else for a bit. Yeah.
is helpful just to think about something alone, because you want quiet time in your own head to understand things, and it takes, you know, people different amounts of time, different ways to try and understand something. But it's very helpful for me to then, once I get a grasp on something, to work with someone. Because I like talking about things in order to think about it. It helps me think about something if I verbalize. Sometimes you don't even necessarily have to be working with someone. You can just explain to them what your problem is. And in the process of explaining, you can generate new ideas. It's quite similar to how if you start writing and journaling, you generate a lot more ideas that you didn't think of in your brain when you're just thinking about it. But if you start writing it down, it's like somehow it helps solidify the thought process. So if I try to explain some to somebody the problems I'm working on, it kind of helps me think about it as well.
Okay, so what's the dynamic of the points?
Okay, so there are n eigenfunctions in the original chain. Once you project it, there are still n eigenfunctions.
And RTA did give us a hint about it when he spoke to me at tea today, which was something along the lines of showing that the limsup that you end up with is invariant under scaling of some sort.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the only thing that we really need to be concerned about is how large can they be in absolute value aside from the eigenvalue of 1. Because we know there's not 1 with minus 1 because our random walk is aperiodic.
There's actually nice... So, okay, I mean... Okay, so this picture that they're giving us, right? Mm-hmm. The more n's there are, the closer you imagine that could get to 0, which makes the spectral gap bigger. And that corresponds with the intuition that the more n's there are, it takes longer to mix.
Okay, so some circle like this. Mm-hmm. Then this this function that we're working with, phi sub j, is multiplying all of these by... all of the positions by an additional factor of j, right? So that means in particular...
So that's how we live all day with no windows, the glamorous life of mathematician.
Pros and cons of being in California, right?
Yeah.
Pros, the weather is glorious a lot of the time. Cons, like
the weather is glorious.
Yeah, a lot of times I wish I was out in the weather rather than in here. But
yeah.
We're looking through his textbook right now, doing a reading course with a professor in the stats department, Alan Sly. Essentially, it's a simple probabilistic system where you're looking at a system that transitions between a number of different states, and the probability of transitioning basically is independent of things that happened beforehand. Yeah, so it's a simple-ish sort of model, but it tends to reflect a lot of real-world systems. And so
I guess it's motivated from applied math,
yes.
But the theory is, I mean, what we're examining really has.
I mean,
I'd
say
much.
That there's a lot of interaction between the two sides of it. You know, there's a lot of theoreticians working on some of the more pure parts of it, but then there's a lot of applied mathematicians using it for other.
I find it's hard to make a distinction the more I go into mathematics between what is applied and what is pure, because they influence each other very, very richly. So, for example, I think in the last beginning of the last century, even nowadays, questions and objects in mathematics and ways to different directions to explore math are very much influenced by questions in physics. But once mathematicians take this motivation and bring it within mathematics proper, and develop more mathematics on top of that, it's very hard afterwards when you're on the surface layer to know what that initial motivation was, and that's actually pure mathematics. But yes, it's indeed, I was drawn to mathematics originally because of its methodology, but in the end I realized I stayed in it because of the how rich the actual objects are.
Feet don't fail me now. Take me to the finish line.
the song for the first time in the car. Like, I don't drive, my boyfriend was driving, and then, like, and then, cause, have you seen the video for this?
Yes.
Because you know how, like, she's kissing her boyfriend, and that's how they kind of die in the end? So he doesn't know this song, and he starts kissing me in the car, and I was like, you know what's really funny? This video teaches you not to do that so you don't die.
Don't make me sad, don't make me cry. Sometimes life is not enough and the road gets tough. I don't know.
Blinded by sunshine. So that makes it hard. And then sometimes it's just, it's conceptually, I was gonna say conceptually risque. It's not exactly what I mean. I mean, just it's, oh my God, look at that. What is that? Is that a mushroom? What do you call those? Wow, it's like a zoo here. We're just like, oh my God, we never see wildlife. What is this? And so that is not a very pure subject, but it's still interesting and it feels empowering that you can use mathematics. look at that. Yeah, it feels very empowering that you can use mathematics to tackle these issues. It's so necessary. You know, you have kind of live in this world. And it's incredible how you can use the human mind to think about things that are so not obvious just from sensing, from blind sensing, you know? Like, and by blind sensing, I mean like, okay, yeah, we can look at things and there's color and then there's sensation, there's smells and whatever. And then you can really try to understand why is it that the world works this way, or why is it that, or even just to investigate, because not all math is about the world, of course. It's very much, it can be very far removed from the world. But just the fact that thought and a kind of rigor of method can be applied so that very non-trivial conclusions can be drawn. Yeah, I think that's what makes it. It just makes it, interesting to live, because there's such rich worlds of structures you can learn about and explore. And I think any human being is pretty curious about what is beautiful and what is, and so there's a lot of beauty in that, yeah. And so you want to learn more about it, you want to use your mind and apply it.